You know, as anime fans, we feel we need to address something that occasionally crops up in our community, something that makes us ashamed.
It's really something that's frustrating. I mean, I basically pulled all of my hair out almost thinking about something like this.
I mean, a lot of people love anime. You know, if you were watching Cartoon Network, you know, in the early 2000s, you know, anime was like this big boom in America. It was suddenly this big, big thing. You know, Toonami, Adult Swim. But there are some people that feel that the world revolves around them. And that anime and how it's presented should conform to their standards.
All about me, it's my way or the highway. Sounds a lot like a certain other group of people that we've talked about on here before.
Yes, indeed. Excuse me, but I'm recovering from a cough. Hopefully that doesn't happen too often during this. But we are going to be going into quite a rant that could very well, this could very well be many parts, so forgive us in advance.
Hopefully this doesn't take us too long. Hopefully this is, hopefully we don't go too off topic. Hopefully we don't have any problems. Hopefully we can stay on target for as much of this, but it's time for us to purge, to get this out. We need to get this out. We need to have people know what we're all about.
And the people that we want to address are the anime purists, the anime elitists. Now, what are these? These are the people that want to anime to be released in their utmost, purest form possible.
Meaning, basically, completely no edits to the video, no alterations, nothing that should be changed with it whatsoever. If it even had, I'm not even sure if this even qualifies as a having just a dub as well, if that also includes the fact that these people hate it so much. But it's basically, you know, it's what they want. And screw everyone else and everyone else that has something like that is awful, terrible people.
Now, we have nothing against subtitled anime. I mean, you know, if there's an anime that I want to watch where the only option is subtitled, I will take it. I have nothing against subtitles.
Nor do I.
I mean, you know, Urusei Yatsura, one of my favorite animes in the world, is pretty much only subtitle. You know, Ataru Moroboshi is one of my favorite kids. You know, I would love to be a voice actor. And, you know, subtitles is a good opportunity for me to practice voices as I watch it. That's a very fun activity for me. Ataru Moroboshi and Urusei Yatsura is one of the characters I would love to play if I hypothetically were able to become a voice actor.
Now, just to say this as well, I mean, even I have some subtitled stuff only in my collection as well. Probably the one thing that I know the most that I have is a Discotech release copy of Lupin the Third Episode Zero First Contact, which was released by Discotech a few years ago, and I picked it up based on some recommendations, and I didn't care that it was sub only. It was a fun thing. It was fun to watch. It was entertaining. It was all the things that I loved about Lupin the Third all thrown into one DVD, and I'm also really happy that the woman called Fujiko Mine, or Mine, or whatever the heck you want to call it, that's coming out later this year by Funimation. I'm excited for that, and that's definitely going in my collection. I would probably really consider getting it, even if it was only dubbed. I mean, the fact that that's being dubbed is icing on the cake, as far as I'm concerned.
But yeah, I was talking before about Urusei Yatsura and Atoru Moroboshi. Speaking of Atoru Moroboshi,
it's time for us to stop tap dancing around this, because it is time for us to start on it. Here is what we're going after.
We stumbled on an Amazon customer review of the Robotech box set from A&E.
The A&E box set, which is probably the most accessible way to get Robotech these days. You've probably seen the individual collections of Robotech for sale, basically based on sagas. You've probably seen them for sale at places like Walmart, I know I have, where they sell like the one part of the saga at a time.
But yes, this customer review, by the username of Moroboshi Ataru.
How dare you use the name of such a great character?
Yeah. But yes, this review and the comments herein, he was flooded by comments, and he vehemently attacked anybody who tried to defend the series. And in true troll fashion would often post responses to his own posts. And this is a mental case I don't think I've seen before. I mean, this is a person who in his attacks claims to have worked in the anime industry as a translator, and claims that he has spoken with Tatsunoko and stuff like that, and how they hated the series, supposedly. And I seriously doubt this guy's credibility, the way he throws insults at people. I mean, you know, this guy claims to be professional. A professional would not be throwing insults at people.
He's a professional. A professional what now?
Yeah. But yes, he begins his customer review saying, Robotech is not anime. It is a series of three anime that were re-edited and dubbed, and the actual story material was thrown out and replaced by a storyline that was essentially made up. Since the dialogue has nothing to do with the original dialogue, and the story has only the loosest connection to the original, this cannot be called an anime. You can't have a movie or TV show and throw out the actual story and dialogue and just keep the picture. It is no longer the same show. If you have Beavis and Butthead dubbed Casablanca, it's not Casablanca anymore.
Now, I'm not going to doubt that there's at least a little bit of truth to this, but at the same time, to not call Robotech anime, that is...
Yeah.
I don't know how anyone can even say anything of the sort. I mean, okay, the series itself is not the series that it was based off of, but at the same time, it was also a series that they brought over and they successfully made a rather good mythology around, especially when you consider that it's a series that's that took three separate shows and put them together. And what worked for this was the fact that at least all three shows really had similar designs to one another, at least in characters. I mean, okay, some were better designed than others, but all three shows that were used in Robotech were by Tatsunoko and by Studio Neue.
Now, he goes on, every company that ever reissued Robotech lost money because the only people who will buy this are people who are fooled by calling it anime and Robotech's perplexing fans. Let's face it, Robotech fans are a small group of people who are incapable of perceiving how bad it is.
Now, we're going to talk about a certain aspect about this guy at the end of his comments.
Yes.
But it's really frustrating to look at this to say every company that has ever reissued Robotech has lost money. I would like to see some facts about that. I mean,
show some statistics, please.
I mean, did ADV really lose all that money when they issued Robotech way back then? I hardly think so. Especially given the fact that they didn't pay Japan to re they didn't pay Japan, all they had to pay was a Harmony Gold, so I can't imagine that they spent that much money reissuing it. Not to mention as well the fact that it's the fact that you know, why would a media company like Arts and Entertainment, like A&E, waste their time on something like this if they didn't think that they were gonna be able to recoup the money spent?
And to say that few people like it, you know, Robotech wasn't unpopular in the 80s. You see Robotech pop up on all sorts of lists. You see it pop up on Cracked and Topless Robot, and you see it pop up, you know, parodied in Lil Former's webcomic. You see the intro pop up in, you know, collections of classic 80s cartoon intros. This was not a small thing.
No.
It wasn't as big as Transformers or Thundercats or He-Man and that stuff.
Granted, it probably hasn't had the lasting impact that some of those 80s shows had.
But it wasn't small, you know?
Hardly. All right, I mean, this was... Always remember, this when Robotech premiered, this was in the days of, like, pre-cable television. This was not a time where there were, like, over 500 channels that you could just click onto with your DirecTV or Verizon Fios subscription. No, you only had, like, about maybe a dozen channels, if that, maybe 20 at the most. And that's not even including if you don't have, like, the if you didn't have, like, the UHF channels.
I seem to remember just being Fox, NBC, CBS, ABC.
Well, yeah. Well, even then, I think that was well before. I think even when Robotech on, I don't think that the Fox network as itself existed at that point.
That's a fair point. It was close, though.
It was close to that time. I don't think Fox came in until, like, 87 or something. I could be completely wrong on that.
This was 85.
But it's just to think about that, you know, that they had enough faith in this show from Japan to bring it over and broadcast it on the air. Granted, they took some liberties with a few things, but overall, it was not a it was not a small thing, and you couldn't be a small thing if you had the ability to do that. And it's not like that Robotech was the first show that did that. No, they were hardly the first show that did that. I mean, let's think about some of the shows that that were on television before Robotech. Starblazers,
Astro Boys,
Speed Racer,
Kimba.
What else?
Battle of the Planets.
That's also true. We're going to get into that as well a little bit later, because that kind of runs into what we're kind of talking about here.
Yeah, because, you know, something I've noticed is that a lot of these people that tend to attack Robotech and the late Carl Masek, a pattern I've seen is that these kind of people, they don't attack Battle of the Planets, which in my opinion, really butchered Science Ninja Team Gatchaman. You know, I think, you know, Sandy Frank has a lot more to answer for than Carl Masek.
I would agree with that myself.
They don't attack Voltron. They don't attack Saber Rider and the Star Sheriffs.
And for a more modern example, they don't attack stuff like Power Rangers, which is very plainly sort of like the things where you take two separate things and you're mashing them together to form a new kind of story.
They don't even attack Samurai Pizza Cats, which completely threw out the script.
And if you want to even come up even closer to that, there was an ADV series called Ghost Stories that was released about the middle of the 2000s.
Around 2005.
Right around 2005, and it was a show that that the original series itself wasn't very well memorable.
It was a horror suspense series.
Until ADV got a hand on it, and they were given permission from the Japanese rights holders to basically do whatever the heck they wanted to, and in the end, you wound up getting probably one of the more well-regarded dubs of the 2000s.
They turned a horror suspense anime into a comedy with its dialogue.
And it worked.
It worked, and the Japanese creators praised them. So these people, these attackers, they don't attack these shows, which leads me to the theory that they only attack Robotech because he bothered to do Macross. If you touch Macross, you're a dead man.
And even I kind of look at that theory, and I have to admit, there has to be some amount of truth to it, because we see it happen with a lot of these shows, with a lot of shows these days. I mean, and to even go a little bit further with shows that have been edited for the American release, I mean, Funimation has sort of made kind of a recent a trend of that with their releases of Crayon Shin-Chan and Sergeant Frog. Now, with Crayon Shin-Chan, of course, you know, you had to edit a lot of those things together to make it work, but at least with Sergeant Frog, all that really was just punching up some of the dialogue and rewriting some of the jokes, most of which wouldn't have even translated to an American audience anyway, because Japanese humor and American humor are two separate entities.
Yes. This also holds true for the pioneer release of Lupin the Third.
That's also very true, because which was the Lupin the Third that actually aired on Adult Swim, and I highly regard that because I felt as though that was a funny dub. I think that everyone involved in that dub was absolutely spot on. From, you know, I mean,
Michelle Ruff
is
Tony Oliver, star of Robotech.
I was gonna say that as well. The same man that played Rick Hunter ended up playing Lupin the Third about 20 years later. And of course, you also had Lex Lang as Goemon, who I thought, you know, he played him so dryly, but at the same time, it was also so much fun. And Richard Epcar as Goemon, who I also thought was, and unfortunately, I can't remember the guy who played Zenigata in that show. Although it is kind of ironic thinking about that, because they announced the cast list for the woman called Fujiko Mine series from Funimation. Michelle Ruff is actually reprising her role as Fujiko, but rather than having Richard Epcar reprise his role as Jigen, he's actually going and playing Zenigata, which is kind of a roundabout dynamic. But speaking of roundabout, we're going around and round here. I think we need to get back on topic.
Mr. Motoboshi Ataru continues. What I did, speaking of his so-called profession, is do a better job of rewriting and translation, supervising several series. I am quoted as an expert on Japanese pop culture, both here and in Japan.
Okay, you're quoted as it.
Yes. Let's see some quotes.
Do you have links to articles? I mean, are you possibly Otaku USA editor-in-chief Patrick Macias? If you're you bring up a Japanese pop culture expert, that's really one of the people, an American person, that honestly I think of, but I know for a fact, I don't think that Patrick would actually hide behind something like saying that he's quote unquote Moriboshi Ataru.
He goes on, the show was made by a guy who had nothing but contempt for both the show and anime in general. And he said as much many times.
Again, where is the proof?
When did he say that?
When? I mean, if anyone wants to point us to something where he did say that, please do.
Yeah.
And we'll be more than willing to say that we're wrong on this.
As far as he was concerned, anime was just something for him to use to make money for himself. And he said that he felt it was no good until he fixed it.
There might be an element of truth to what he's saying, that, you know, Masek only cared about making money for himself, but really when you get into an entertainment business, that's really the bottom line, is that you have to make money or else you're going to find yourself, you know, you're going to bankrupt your studio and you're going to find yourself out of a job.
He goes on to say, Robotech did nothing for anime except give it a reputation for being schlock and kiddie fare that no adult would want to watch. It did nothing to popularize anime because it didn't. It isn't anime at all.
Now, hold on a moment. Really?
Yeah.
Really? This guy says it did nothing for anime. This guy says it did nothing to popularize it. This guy says that this is the show that it's that is considered schlock and kiddie fair. Robotech? Really? With its giant robots and everything like that?
People dying.
People dying and people just finding every kind of thing. Pardon my friend while he brings out a Ricola here. people dying. People getting shot up to heck. Three separate stories. Okay, maybe there are certain things that don't fit very well. How is it schlock? Can someone please inject a little sanity here and tell me how Robotech is schlock? I hardly see it. I mean, it certainly has a better mind on itself than most cartoons of today. There are very few cartoons that I say would probably be at Robotech's level when it comes to maturity.
These days, it would probably be the Avatar Last Airbender series and possibly Transformers Prime.
Those are the only two shows that I can look at and say, you know, those are two that you could honestly say are, at least in tone anyway, maybe not necessarily in story, at least the two most similar to how Robotech really operated as a franchise. That it the fact that it did feel like it was taking itself seriously, the fact that it was this sweeping epic that spanned, you know, three generations of characters, and think about that for a second. The fact that you're actually swapping out characters in the middle of your show. What show would honestly have the balls to do that? I can't.
Power Rangers Turbo. I had to.
Linkara's gonna have some words for that. If you wanna know everything that you wanna need to know about Power Rangers Turbo, watch
Linkara's History of Power Rangers. Move on.
More specifically, the final minute of part one of his Turbo review. That gives everything.
Moving on.
Shut up. But no, seriously, it's like most companies wouldn't even dream of trying to change their characters. That's the point that I'm trying to make here. The fact that these guys felt as though that this was the way that they needed to progress their story, you have to give them credit for that, if nothing else, for taking huge calculated risks on that, because it could have easily blown up in their face as what happened with Generation 1 of Transformers.
He goes on, the correct argument is that there really is no such thing as Robotech. It is just a name slapped on something which already has a legitimate name.
I'm not going to deny that Macross is a terrific series, and it's one of those, you know, staple shows of anime that everyone who honestly considers themselves an anime fan should at least sit down and at least try to get through it.
Especially Do You Remember Love?
Especially that movie. I mean, really, I would recommend people maybe go see that and go watch that movie. You can find that movie on YouTube. I know we're not trying to condone fan subbing, but because Do You Remember Love was never released here in America, that's kind of our only recourse at this moment.
And to say that it was just a name slapped on, again, Robotech as a name existed before the series as a series of model kits from Revell.
So think about that for a second. I mean, we're going through all of this. We're not even part of the way done, people. We got a long way to go.
This is a madman. He goes on, by claiming Robotech is an anime, you are intentionally trying to deceive people into thinking that this is an animated production from Japan that has been translated.
Okay.
Somewhat?
I mean, go ahead and read the next point, and then I'm going to offer some thoughts on this.
It's a somewhat translation, because aside from the Master Saga, the Southern Cross portion, not that much is different from the Macross and Mospita portion. With the Macross portions, the changes come down to two things. First is slight changes to character names.
Maybe the most drastic being
Rick Hunter from Hikaru Ichijo. But with other character names, you got Misa Hayase to Lisa Hayes. Captain Global to Captain Global.
You have Max Genius.
Or Genius.
Or Genius to
Max Sterling. You have Roy Fokker
to Roy.
Not Meet the Fockers.
To Roy Fokker.
To Roy Fokker. The Bridge Bunnies are still named Vanessa, Kim, and Sammy. What changes are these people talking? They're minimal at best.
And honestly, anyone that has watched anime for any period of time through the late 90s and early 2000s know that name changes are nothing new.
Sailor Moon. Digimon.
Pokemon. Cardcaptors.
Didn't change the names that much. I mean,
well, even Madison, not that much.
It's still got Lee Shaoran or Lee Shouran. You still got Sakura, though she's Sakura Avalon, but
pronounced Sakura Avalon.
Oh yeah. That was a common American mistake.
You wouldn't be able to get away with that these days. But as we were moving right along.
He goes on further. You don't present your opinions, is speaking to a commenter, as opinions. You state categorically how wonderful this monstrosity is without any attempt at qualification. And no, you are not entitled to this opinion or to spread it around in the deceptive way Robotech fans are prone to do.
Gee, where have I heard this kind of talk from people on the opposite side of fandom before? I wonder.
Yeah, and to say that he's not entitled to his opinion?
Again, sounds very similar to a certain other group of fans.
Yeah.
Onward.
He goes on.
Yes, he does go on. We are not kidding on this, people. You can go on to Amazon and find this guy's
review. The link will be provided.
It's not going to be that difficult.
He goes on. It would not be one person's opinion. It is the fact as determined by the market. The anime community in general doesn't have an opinion, and even if it did, certainly you don't speak for it, as I do. I've worked in the industry since the late 80s and was involved in the fandom since the 70s, and your perspective is that you like a horrible show? I have evidence and proofs for my conclusions. All you have is an opinion that goes against all the evidence. There is a theory that everyone is entitled to an opinion. But since yours is demonstrably wrong, I'd have to say yours is meaningless. So yeah, the guy is pretty much saying, your opinion sucks, so it's invalid. What
the fuck? I mean, wow. I could make some comments here, but again, I'm saving it for the end.
And he claims to be a professional in the industry.
Can we get an IMDb link? Can we get an Anime News Network link? Can we get a link to something that this guy worked on if he says he's worked in the industry, please? I don't think it's that difficult. Everything's online these days, people.
He goes on, it's pretty much the obsession of a group of very sad people. Very sad people more than 40 years old, apparently. It has a tiny fan following. No market equals no fans, period. Did we have some examples for this?
No market equals no fans?
No, I mean, you know, a very small group of people.
Okay, I mean, just on one show. Let's think about this for a second. I actually have this. The guy is basically coming down on the opinion of Robotech fans.
Yeah.
So people that even, you know, casually enjoy the series, kind of like us.
And again, you know, it's not... Again, this has been... this is a topic that has come up on Cracked. It's come up on Topless Robot. It's come up in Lil Formers. It's not a small thing.
But let's also think about this for a moment. This guy is basically coming after an entire group of fans to try and basically say, you guys suck because you like this show. Let me give you a brief analog as to maybe a show that we don't like nearly, that we really do not like in any way, shape, or form, and that's Code Geass.
Yeah.
Code Geass was a show that was released in the middle part of the 2000s. It was broadcast on Adult Swim, really around the time where Adult Swim really started to appear that they were no longer the place to go to get the new anime, because that was the show, along with Morabito, that got so unceremoniously dumped into the 5 a.m. Time slot, even though those shows were really doing, you know, pretty decently for them at midnight. Regardless of it, just elements in the show and story parts of the show left such an impact on us in a negative sense that both MC Squared and I, we both agreed that we would never buy this show, period. Not even if it was available for, if I could get all 52.
Is a terrible person.
Not if I could get every, if I could get all 52 episodes for $1, I still wouldn't buy it. There are certain shows that I wouldn't mind, you know, spending a buck and getting a whole series. I would not spend a dime towards Code Geass. However, I'm not going to go waste my time on sites like Amazon, where you can go and probably still find the complete collections of Code Geass. I'm not going to go there and start a shitstorm over the series, basically calling these people horrible human beings, which is pretty much what this guy is saying. I don't like Code Geass, and I realize that there's a lot of people that do like Code Geass. I understand that there's a certain appeal to Code Geass, even though I feel that the appeal is nothing more for Yaoi fangirls that just want to see Lelouch and Suzaku get it on, but that's another subject. It's really just, I would never go and do that. It's a lot like just being a fan of anything. You know what? If you're a fan of that, that's great. I don't have a problem with that. Look, even if you're fans of stuff like, say, let's say if you were a fan of the Jersey Shore, you know what? If that's the way you want to spend your nights watching, you know, a bunch of these morons basically beat up on each other, go ahead, fine. But you know something? I'm not going to waste my time trying to tear you down, because you know what? Different people like different things, and I'm probably one of the more people that has one of the more diverse groups of interests as to what I like. I mean. My name should honestly say it all. They're called the Otaku Jock. I wear different sports shirts every single time I've done a video, with the exception of the very first video that we did. And yet, I still like these geeky exploits. Anime, video games, books, reading. It's not...
He is the nerdy sports guy.
I am not one of these guys that's just going to go out there and basically say, oh, you know, you're terrible for not liking what I like, and, you know, go watch this. I mean, if I felt as though that maybe there are people that... Give you another example. Like, say, you know...
It is an example. Wrestling's fake!
And you know something? Here's the thing. I make no bones to say that wrestling isn't fake. I know it. I would argue that probably 90% of the people that watch wrestling know that it's fake. But what we... But we watch it... Because number one, to watch professional wrestling is to watch, you know, athletic gentlemen, and even some women at sometimes, basically have to go out there and put on a show. It's no different than putting on a regular television show, like, say, a CSI, or even like an action show, like, say, Flashpoint, for instance, which I watched a couple episodes not that long ago, and that's not that bad of a show. It's no different from anything like that. And another example I should also bring up is, say, let's use a hypothetical here. Let's say that someone likes the dub of Cardcaptors. The Nirvana dub of Cardcaptor Sakura aired on Kids WB at the turn of the century. Pretty unfortunately known for its editing, its name changes, and everything, for really what's really held up as probably one of the better shows of the 1990s. I would not begrudge anyone who still likes card captors, especially considering the fact that there is a contingent of fans out there who saw card captors in its infancy and then went back later and saw the actual uncut series and fell in love with the series even more. I honestly love Cardcaptor Sakura. I even have a small spot in my heart for the original Cardcaptor's dub. So it's really not mutually exclusive that you have to like one or the other. So that's basically my point. And as for the whole pro wrestling thing, let's just say that I'm going to make a video that really goes into why I have really started to enjoy pro wrestling in the last few years pretty soon. Probably you'll see that in hopefully in a month or so.
Moving on. The anime community in general considers Robotech garbage and considers Carl Masek a butcher and has done so for years.
Now, I'm not going to deny that there's probably an ounce of truth to the fact that they refer to Masek as a butcher, but at the same time, when you look at what Masek did, you look at them on a let's use a more modern example. Let's compare what Masek did at Streamline Pictures to what, say, Alfred Kahn did at 4Kids. Now, granted, I mean, we can, I know that the problems with 4Kids are numerous because, but let's think about that. So they had their big success with Pokemon, their big, huge smash success. And then Yu-Gi-Oh, which was another smash success. And even Yu-Gi-Oh was even edited to a certain degree, but, you know, people still enjoyed it. I mean, let's face it, I don't think that people do Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged if they at least don't have an appreciation
for the show.
So, but going off from that, the moment that they got their, that they basically took over the Saturday morning Fox block with Foxbox, that's when I think a lot of people say, they look at 4Kids and say, you know, what the hell happened? Especially, and this is well documented. Especially when they began broadcasting One Piece.
And if I could interject, we saw a panel once with Christopher R. Sabat from Funimation, and someone asked him.
I have a question: did you ever watch the original 4Kids version of One Piece? And if so, what were your thoughts on it?
The answer to your first question, yes. Not by choice. And answer second question, I think that 4Kids is a fantastic company. They provide fantastic alternatives to anime. That could be enjoyed by anyone as young as two. That's all I can say. They actually, in some defense of that, 4Kids was trying to do what Funimation is trying to do, and that's what 4Kids is set up for. I mean, the name of their company, come on. They're trying to just make shows that are popular for kids on Saturday morning, so you can't really fault them.
Which is a very fair point that I've been pointing out for a while.
It is a very fair point, and to that point, I don't necessarily put the blame on 4Kids for wanting to try to make the show work. I blame 4Kids for the fact that, number one, they should have known what they were getting in the first place. Number two, the fact that they promised that they were going to release the series uncut, but they never did. They only got like one disc in, and that was 3 episodes, and that was it. By comparison, going back to Cardcaptors, even though Nelvana did the dub of Cardcaptors and released that, Pioneer still released the entire series uncut, subtitled, in a separate DVD release. So there's just a comparison of one show that worked and one show that somehow didn't work. I still look at One Piece as one of the biggest missed opportunities in anime in the United States, but that's another topic for another video.
And to say that the anime community in general considers this, you know, garbage and blah 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 blah, you had something to say about podcasts.
Okay. Perfect examples of about this. Probably one of the more well-known anime review podcasts that's out there on the internet is the Anime World Order podcast. I'm honestly a big fan of it because I just really like how these guys really go in depth and how they review the shows. One of the episodes that they did a very, very long time ago, because the show's actually, believe it or not, the show's actually been going on since like 2006, even though they don't do really weekly episodes and they update rather sporadically. One of the episodes that they did involved a review of Macross, Do You Remember Love? And in that review, the host and the reviewer of the show, Daryl Surratt, said that the Macross, that the Robotech version of Macross wasn't necessarily that far off the mark. And I upon watching it, it's like I never even noticed that there's really this controversy. Maybe it's because I'm coming at this at a completely unbiased position, because I never grew up watching Robotech on television in the 80s, and I never saw Macross until, you know, hearing about it very recently.
Yeah. He goes on.
Didn't you want to say something about maybe what the other big change was in Robotech?
I can't remember if I addressed this, but yeah, the other change, apart from name changes, was the definition of protoculture. So you got name changes and the definition of the MacGuffin.
That's really all that there is.
That's really the main change.
And really, a different MacGuffin, a change in the MacGuffin, it really isn't... It's really not a huge bearing on the plot. At least I don't think it is.
I mean, you know, the government change is really for set up towards the next two sagas. But, you know, if you take away those two sagas and even and just ignore the master's footage that was put in towards the end of the Macross saga, it's really nothing to get worked up about.
I mean, I didn't even notice, so that should tell you something about just how seamless it seemed like the transition was. So moving on from that, we're still going strong. We're going to go ahead and try to power through some of these a little bit quicker.
We're going to try. He goes on, if you're a RoboSuck fan, he tends to replace the word Robotech with a lot of insults.
Again, we'll discuss this at the end of this.
Your perspective isn't exactly to be trusted. In fact, there's a case to be made that it is likely you can't tie your shoes.
Do we really need to go into this? I mean, no, we don't need to go into this because we got plenty of this to say at the end.
He can tie his shoes. Yeah.
Yeah, I can tie my shoes. This guy can tie his shoes. I can guarantee you that there's a lot of people out there that like Robotech that can tie your shoes. I know that's probably hyperbole, but Christ, man.
Now, he goes on, if it wasn't for Bozotech, and this is a professional. And the other horror,
on his word. It's a professional.
If it wasn't for Bozotech and other horrible, vandalized dubs, anime would have been in the U.S. market earlier and better.
Wait a minute. There is
no indication whatsoever that Robo-Dirt had any effect on the market of anime in the U.S. Certainly, the releases and companies that sprang up to distribute anime didn't happen until years later, and the first success in the market came from releasing accurate subtitles, not bad dubs like Masek the Multer did.
What world is this moron living in?
Alright, to say that it would have happened sooner...
I mean, that's patently false already, because it was already on at that point.
The burden of proof is on you, man.
Yeah.
You're saying that we can't prove that something that didn't happen didn't happen. You're making the same exact claim.
Right. I mean, well, first off, I mean, we've already made the point in this video about the number of shows that had already been on the air in America prior to Robotech coming on. And so, just to say that it would have come in earlier after Robotech, I mean, okay, maybe there were some bad lessons taught about the practice of how it was, of how Robotech was edited, but at the same time, it was still not a terrible process, regardless of what anyone says. I mean, it was just, it's, ooh, I'm trying to get my thoughts together here. My mind is starting to short circuit because of just the levels of denseness that this gentleman has. I'm assuming it's a gentleman. Why don't we just move on to the next point before I really start having to hurt something?
He goes on, get the facts straight. Masek the Mangler destroyed many anime the same way as Robosnot. Masek the Mangler vandalized the show on purpose because he had no respect for the material. Do you have any links that?
Again, the burden of proof is on you to prove that. Really, not a whole lot of us are against taking a look at other, sources. I mean, for me, being a writer by definition, I have to look at sources. That's why I never take the very first report of anything that happens at face value until I hear it reported on reputable sites. Like, if there's something breaking on Facebook, I immediately go when I check on, say, CNN, which I feel as though I can go on there and check that and then figure out where it goes from there.
Now, a user said, if it wasn't for Robotech and Captain Harlock and Battle of the Planets and Star Blazers back then, there's a good chance anime might never have spread in the U.S. And which Moriboshi says,
oh boy.
Really? And you can prove that something that never happened might have happened? Anime might have entered the U.S. market? You know, this guy's repeating himself.
He's repeating himself. All right. I mean,
the burden of proof is on you snobs that live in this world of fantasy.
It's really just it's just frustrating for me to keep hearing this because he's basically making the same points over and over and over again and just using more of it to just be maniacal about his points. Let's face some reality here, Buster. The whole reason that anime has had the problem, okay, Let's think about the problems that anime has had in, like, the last 5 years or so, all right? And I'm not going to go the direct route and say that piracy has been the root cause of it. I'm not going to say that it's not a cause of it, but let's face it, when really you can only have it aired on one major network on one day late at night, there really is something that has to be said about exposure to it. And the fact that anime doesn't get near as much exposure as it did during the heyday, right around the turn of the century in the early 2000s, it's really one of those, it's really something that you look back on and say, why isn't this? Part of it is because, some of the people that were in charge back then aren't in charge right now, and the philosophy of the new people that are in charge are much different than the philosophy of the people that were in charge. That's the easy answer right on that. And as a matter of fact, if you want a really good example about how to do this, going back to Anime World Order, they did an entire episode about the shutdown of Bandai Entertainment.
In which we'll get to later on.
We will get to that later on.
He goes on. Dubs have proved to have retarded the entry of anime into the market.
How? Okay, I'm not denying that there are some dubs out there that are absolute shit. But you can't sit here and tell me that if there was a show that was Japanese only on television, that people would be more inclined to watch it. I'm trying to see your logic here, man, and it's not working. You mean that trying to broadcast something in Japanese with no real ability to subtitle, because closed captioning really wasn't set up until maybe the late 80s, early 90s, that somehow it just does not add up. It really just does not add up.
He goes on, the three series within Robotech could have been connected without completely disregarding the original story.
Now, the only one that was really discarded here was Southern Cross.
Now, let me say something about Southern Cross. In Japan, Southern Cross was a failure.
It was canceled early.
It was canceled. It was meant to be, like, I guess 36 like Macross, but it was doing so poorly that they cut it down to, like, 24 episodes and rushed the ending. Now, an associate of mine has said that, a commentator, has said that Robotech needs Macro. Robotech needs Southern Cross.
Yes.
Because it made it more interesting than what Southern Cross was already. He said, what did Robotech do to actually make Southern Cross watchable?
Yes. I mean, okay, there's the story, and I'm hearing this, secondhand, if nothing else. I think I heard at one point that the way that Carl Masek did Southern Cross is that he watched the episodes on mute and wrote his own dialogue. And in regards to that, Master Saga, even when it comes to Robotech, is still regarded as probably the weakest chapter in the Robotech saga, it's still regarded as a better overall series than Southern Cross.
Mm-hmm.
So there obviously has to be something to what Carl Masek did if people still regard Southern Cross as maybe regard Masters as an improvement over Southern Cross.
He goes on, Masek the Mangler created nothing. He neither wrote Macross, nor promoted it, nor animated it. He merely trashed it. Any vandal or criminal can ruin something wonderful someone else made. It's not an accomplishment.
Okay, first...
Didn't MC Hammer create Can't Touch This by sampling Super Freak? Didn't Vanilla Ice Ice Baby by sampling Under Pressure?
Didn't Kanye West sample Daft Punk in Stronger for one of his more successful songs? Something like that.
Coolio sampling Stevie Wonder with Gangsta's Paradise?
Where do you go from this? It's almost like it's impossible to please anyone. Okay. The point that he makes here, he's like, he neither wrote Macross nor he produced it. Okay, you know what? No one ever denies that he had nothing to do with Macross. No one ever denies that. Not even Masek himself, when he was alive, ever denied that he was...
Watch panels. Read books.
A lot of his panels, including the very last one that he did when he was passed away.
You will never... see or read anything where Masek says, well, I created Robotech when I was looking up at fighter planes. You will never hear that.
And if you do hear that, send it to us and we'll consider ourselves wrong. All right? I'm like some other people, we're not above being saying that we're wrong in this, in saying some of these things. If we're wrong, tell us. We'll correct it. We'll come back in a video later and say, okay, we made a mistake right here. We're not above that.
He goes on, since you called Masek the Mutilator a nice guy, he's commenting to the people that, have seen panels with him, that have gotten to meet him, shook his hand, that kind of stuff. Since you call him a nice guy, you apparently don't know him at all. He was not, in fact, a nice guy. He was a con artist and a thief. Where's your proof?
A thief. You're calling Masek a thief. Let's think about that for a second. He worked with Tatsunoko to bring Robotech over.
Oh, but he gets to that.
I mean, crossover, I should say.
He gets to that. He goes on, no, Tatsunoko Productions had nothing to do with the Robotech dub. They did not allow him to do it. They sold the U.S. rights through a series of misunderstandings and have regretted it ever since. I have been to Tatsunoko and wrote articles about it. You are again talking about things you don't know anything about, just plain making up nonsense.
Where's your proof?
It's your word against everyone else.
Okay, It is known that
Studio Nue
and some of the creators, such as Noboru Ishiguro,
starts with a mess.
Was it
Shoto something? The main guy, his name escapes us at the moment.
Noboru Ishiguro is known as the director of Macross. All right, it is known that those...
It is known that they expressed surprise and concern over the changes. But surprise and concern can mean anything.
Yeah.
Show us the actual articles and maybe we'll, you know, take a different opinion on that. But surprise and concern can mean anything.
Yeah.
But they're not Tatsunoko. He's talking about Tatsunoko.
Shoji Kawamori, that's the guy.
Shoji Kawamori.
That's what I was thinking about. So, I mean, just moving on from that, it is just, it's frustrating in any regard that you have to hear this coming out time and again. And again, like we said, we're not above being proven wrong. Prove us wrong, if indeed. Link us to something. Link us to some actual hard data, and we might be willing to change our minds.
Now, here's where he goes into absolute nuttiness. By saying... dub fans are not anime fans. Apply directly to the forehead. I mean, what planet is this person from? Anime can be enjoyed by people with any preference. It doesn't have to be in its purest, most original form. It's whatever translation works for the person watching it.
Yeah. Okay. Let's do full disclosure right here. Both Morgan and I, we prefer watching dubs.
We prefer it. Just be out of convenience.
Out of convenience.
As explained before, we have nothing against subtitles. We will take it if that's our only option.
Just comparison, in my case, I'm usually doing several different things whenever I am watching anime.
Multitasking.
Whether it be writing, whether it be surfing around online for this, that, and the other thing. But overall, I do it just because, as an animation fan, and I'm going to say this, as an animation fan, I want my attention to be on what's on the screen, not on what's on the bottom. Don't get me wrong, I see the point where people say that you want to have the subtitles, but you're at the point now where dubs are cranked out at fairly good quality. This isn't early 1990s dub quality. It's at a fairly good quality where you can honestly enjoy it.
And the studios keep getting better and better. And people always harp on, well, anime actors suck. They don't get this. They suck bad actors. Funimation has some of the best anime actors in the industry. In fact, you are required to have an acting background in order to even audition at Funimation.
Yep.
And their talent is unfathomable. We've met several of them at conventions.
Some of the nicest people that you will ever come across.
Laura Bailey, Vic Mignogna, Monica Real, I'm even acquainted with Josh Greeley. I mean,
let's also think about the other guys. J. Michael Tatum.
Yeah.
Chris Sabat.
These are not bad actors.
No, they're not bad actors, and they're not bad people. They're probably, like I said, they're probably some of the nicest people that you will ever meet at any convention. I've had the pleasure of asking Vic Mignogna at KatsuCon one year when I went. I asked him if I could get a picture, and he obliged.
Yeah.
Raina
Palencia
obliged
him with a picture.
Oh, we could get into that. But
yeah.
Less said the better.
So now this lunatic goes on, try running a search under stupid Carl Mason quotes and see what happens. Well, you know, I tried that.
You know, an interesting thing when you're told to do something.
You come across another moron. And
you do come across another moron with a bunch of this.
This is from a what looks like a Space 1999 forum, though they seem to be talking about all sorts of science fiction stuff. Someone brought up Robotech, and another moron comes along, and based on some of the points he makes, I'd almost swear it was the same guy.
It really does seem like it's the same guy. Quickly, let's go through this.
Posting as the name Ham Salad. as in the Hardware Wars Han Solo character.
Ham salad.
Ham salad.
Ham salad. Yeah, that's what I would want to be referred to.
The topic of Robotech at one point switched over Carl Masek's Streamline Pictures Akira dub. So yeah, this isn't a whole Robotech thing. This is about dubs in general.
This is about dubs, and this is more about Akira in general.
Username REB posted, Masek did import Akira for an uncut cinema run in the States.
Neo Tokyo is about to explode. Streamline Pictures presents a state-of-the-art adventure, Akira. Akira.
Along with Wicked City and several others. To which Ham Salad replied,
and here we go.
You can't call something uncut when it was totally rewritten and the voice track removed and replaced.
Oh.
What?
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh,
little history lesson. Do you know what uncut means? Do you know what cut means? Little history lesson. In the old days of cinema, the editors wouldn't go into a computer. The editors would take the film into a cutting room, and they would cut out what they don't need. Hence the term cutting room floor. When it comes to anime, the term uncut refers to the footage, not the audio. The audio is a different story.
Yes.
Now, let's separate these. Ham Salad goes on, Masek said publicly that anime was only good when he redid it.
So he's echoing what Moriboshi says. But again, there's no burden of proof. And this is on a forum. So it's very easy for the guy to post the proof and have us basically figure out what we want to talk about.
If anything Carl Masek has said, it's that he found the subtitling process pointless. I'll give that. But to say anime was only good if he redid it, if he changed everything, that he detested the Japanese work, that's, you're stretching things.
That's boring, like that.
He says that Masek's work gave anime the bad reputation that it still suffers from today.
Whoa, what? Are you kidding me?
Bad reputation?
Wait, the reputation that it's not as that it's supposed to be for kids? Again, much like Moriboshi, he's saying that, but at the same time, it doesn't mesh with reality. Honestly, I would say that for kids did a lot more to push that stereotype of anime more than Robotech did. Robotech was going for a much wider audience than just kids.
He did not popularize anime. In fact, he did just the opposite. He gave it a bad reputation and made it something the general public dismisses as junk.
Okay. For that, let's refer you to Doug Walker's or the Nostalgia Critic's Top 11 South Park episodes, where he covered the episodes Chimpokomon and... What was that episode? Good Times with Weapons?
Good Times with Weapons.
Yes. Both of those, which were both taking a look at the...
anime craze.
About the anime craze. And taking a look at it from two different perspectives. And the point that Doug made in those videos was the fact that, you know, obviously they have to have some kind of appreciation for it if they are able to actually make this look as funny as it is.
He goes on, it was three different shows, Robotech, completely rewritten and heavily edited. I don't know what you call cut to pieces, but that's cut to pieces in my dictionary. The only stuff they cut was really stuff for broadcast standards.
Yes. And for the and even and any company that wants to run anime has to run into that at some point.
Because it's not Captain Harlock and the Queen of a Thousand Years, which was two series that they made it seem like they were interjoining with each other. Robotech didn't do that. Robotech was in a sequence.
For that, if you want to know about a particularly funny part of Captain Harlock and the Queen of a Thousand Years,
watch bad anime dubbing.
We will put a link up to bad to Cornpone Flex's bad anime dubbing in the description.
Yes. That's it. It goes on. It was able to retard the penetration of anime into the U.S. market and keep it from being taken seriously for years. He encouraged other producers to hack up and bad dub other shows and ruin them.
Now that kind of goes back to what I'm saying. Maybe that's one of the more unfortunate parts of Masek's legacy, is that maybe people thought that it was okay to do a lot of editing, because I certainly think that that was the case with 4Kids. But at the same time, It caused to retard the progress of anime in America. Let's also think about certain things that were coming out at the time. I mean, okay, I would honestly say that maybe something that that retarded anime's progress might have been more extreme stuff, like say, stuff like Wicked City and stuff like Legend of the Overfiend. Which have these reputations as being just, I mean, you think that stuff like, you know, Saw or Hostel are bad. It's like these things take that kind of stuff to another level. So it really doesn't say that, if anything, that was what retarded anime's progress in it. It really wasn't until Pokemon and the Miyazaki movies came out right around 98-99, where it really seemed that the tide was starting to shift back in the favor of anime, and then Toonami was there to help push it over the top.
Going back to Akira, username REB said, I think we have three different things that we're discussing. Film editing, translation, and dubbing. There are no film edits in the streamlined release of Akira. It is considered uncut. Exactly my point.
Right.
To which Ham Salad says, No, it isn't. It is not considered to anyone aside from Masek fans uncut. REB says, the original script was translated into English, and the dubbing team faced an unusual problem that the Japanese animators had to match the characters' movements to a pre-recorded voice track.
To which he responds to this. Listen to this nonsense.
No, actually it didn't. It's neither unusual, nor did it actually have to match. Since anime mouth movements are syllabic, because Japanese is such. And also, Japanese anime mouth movements are synced on 3 or 4s, every 3 or 4 frames, instead of every frame. So you don't actually need to match mouth movements precisely.
Okay, has this guy even watched Akira? I mean, that is... Okay.
Akira has a weird thing about it, where, you know... Most anime in Japan, because this is completely different than the U.S. In the U.S., we record the dialogue and the anime
We do the dialogue first, and then it's animated around the dialogue. However,
in Japan, they animate first,
and then do
the voices, which is why anime has the characteristic lip movement.
Yeah, that's exactly what it
but
is.
But with Akira...
Otomo did it
the American way. So you can actually see the mouth doing this.
Yeah, and it's even obvious when you watch that it's obviously not animated like a regular movie, because like a regular Japanese cartoon show, because it's so much, there's so much more detail to it. And just by watching it, you can even tell that there's nothing. I mean, first off, I mean, Akira is a beast on its own, first with its realistic character designs, and second with its just animation and its detail in general. I mean, it's stuff that we have, it's stuff that really helped a lot of things, that really showed a lot of things before and since, that really have not even come close to it. I mean, by comparison, Studio Ghibli does work on the mouth movements, but it's not to the same amount of detail the way that Ultimo did. And I would even argue that Mamoru Hosoda, who did The Girl Who Leapt Through Time and Summer Wars, he also kind of goes that Ghibli route as well, but he's not a maniac about the mouth animations the way that Otomo was.
Now, he goes on with the topic of Miyazaki. On the other hand, Disney manages to do it all the time, and pretty much every other company that dubs. And while their efforts aren't perfect, they are not appalling as Masek's are.
I mean, is your definition of not appalling the fact that they actually get famous actors to play these characters? I mean, let's think about Kiki's Delivery Service, the very first Miyazaki film that was released by Disney. Let's think about that. You had Kirsten Dunst. You had Phil Hartman, God rest his soul.
Yeah, Matthew Lawrence.
I believe Matthew Lawrence was in that.
He was one of those Lawrences.
It was. It couldn't have been Martin Lawrence.
Yo, Kiki! What's up, sister?
Calm down.
You killed it.
But REB says, this was a process almost unheard of in the anime industry. It made Sakura challenged to dub into any other language.
Which is very true.
Ham salad. Really? No, I did this, didn't I?
No, you
know. Yes, he says, really? Disney does it all the time, and better. It's common, actually. ADR is standard throughout every country that does animated films, which is pretty much all of them.
Okay, ADR is a widely accepted practice, but at the same time, to completely say that, you know, Disney does it better, I'm not denying that Disney has a better way to do things, because, you know, let's face facts. I mean, you've got more people that are willing to be in these. Look at the amount of people that we've seen be in Studio Ghibli dubs in the past. Let's think about this. Got people like
Liam Neeson,
Tina Fey. Who are some others? Too many to name. I mean, Anton. I mean, from up on Poppy Hill, Anton Yelchin from the new Star Trek movies is in that. Ron Howard was in the new.
Up on Poppy Hill. Jamie Lee Curtis.
Jamie Lee Curtis is another one.
Anna Paquin was in Castle of the Sky.
Anna Paquin. I mean, really, you can.
Mark Hamill.
Yes. You can look at any of the Miyazaki movies that have been released on Blu-ray and DVD by Disney. They put those actors prominently up on the top of the frame, and it is always something that I look at every single time. It's just like, wow, they were actually able to get like really cool people to be in this movie, and it's real impressive.
REB said,
but to go back to my point before you move on, just because they have these great actors on this doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, people that don't have these big names can't do just as good a job, if not a better job, because they're more used to working behind the microphone. I mean, there are plenty of voice actors and actresses that have made livings off of doing voice acting. Probably the one person that we can think of is the best example is probably Tara Strong. You could easily just go on to...
Tara Strong has been doing voice work since she was 13.
Go on to YouTube.
She was Hello Kitty in the 1980s.
Go on to YouTube, type in Tara Strong voices, watch any compilation, you will see how much that lady has worked her entire career, and it is damn impressive.
REB says, I was talking about Streamline, a company that did introduce the concept of distributing anime on home video that had not previously been shown on television, at least in the US. Ham salad. Funny, because it didn't do that. Streamline productions were shown in theaters and sold on tape. To my knowledge, none of them was broadcast.
Wrong, 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 wrong. Wrong, 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 wrong. You're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong.
Really?
Vampire Hunter D was
really?
Broadcast. Robot Carnival was broadcast. Doomed Megalopolis was broadcast. Twilight of the Cockroaches was broadcast. The Kashan was broadcast. Where are you pulling this from?
I mean, let's also remember, even though it's a little hard for us to even think about them having aired it now, Sci-Fi Channel used to be what Adult Swim was back in their...
They had the Saturday anime lineup. Cartoon Network, in the mid-90s, before Toonami ever existed, had a three-run, Saturday Japanime thing, where they showed Vampire Hunter D, Twilight of the Cockroaches, and Robot Carnival. All Streamline features.
You asked for more, and now Cartoon Network's gonna give it to you. Three Saturday nights of intense Japanese animation with Robot Carnival, Vampire Hunter D, and Twilight of the Cockroaches.
Nice move!
Cartoon Network Saturday Japanime begins Saturday night at 12:15 at the best place for cartoons.
So don't even try to tell me that Streamline never got anything on TV, because Streamline did get stuff on the TV. Moving on from that.
Moving on from this. Dubbing a film is editing it. What? No. Because, look. Look at DVDs. Multilingual DVDs. You got one track. You got the other track. The footage is the same.
Yes.
How is that editing?
Oh.
Especially when you have a choice now.
It amazes me that even in this day and age that the whole sub versus dub debate is even a factor now, because it's exactly that. So many DVDs give you both options. It should be a moot point, and yet we still keep going on this very road. Continue.
Referring to people that have met Carl Masick and said he was a nice guy, again on this tangent.
Get ready for a shock!
Ham Salad says, and I saw him too, and talked with him personally, and dealt with him on a professional level. He spoke of it with contempt, and did so often. That's your word.
That's your word.
That's your word against everyone else.
I mean, okay, maybe...
And to cite examples and show some true idiocy, he links the TV Tropes Massacre and a behind-the-voice actor's comparison of Muska from Castle in the Sky comparing one voice actor to another, Mark Hamill. Neither of which have quotes from Carl Masick. Dumbass.
So it's just really... The burden of proof is on him, and it's absolutely failing.
REB says, well, we have seen non-Masick anime on other channels. In fact, anime has had its own television cable channel through ADV, which didn't last very long.
Regrettably. And Funimation still has their channel going strong, but unfortunately, you have to have the right service.
To which REB responds, and let's see, wasn't ADV following the Masick model? Why, yes, it was. Apparently, that was a bad move on their part. It failed.
No. The whole reason things blew up with ADV was because that their deal with a Japanese investment firm fell through so completely when the Japanese company pulled out, because ADV was not performing up to their expectations, and left ADV without any money, and basically forced a good selection of titles, 30 titles with stuff that includes like the second season of Oh My Goddess, 5 centimeters per second, and Sergeant Frog, to be left basically in limbo until Funimation was able to come in there and scoop up a lot of what ADV lost.
Now, REB goes on, Animego is certainly another anime distribution trailblazer, but their efforts are like tears in the rain when it comes to today's anime audiences. To which Ham Salad replies, Animego still exists. Streamline is dead and gone. Animego products are still active in the market.
Wait a minute. Animego products are still active in the market? You know what? Last time...
Purist de Yatsura isn't.
Last I checked, I can't go into a store and pick up the their release of Bubblegum Crisis just right off the shelf. All the stuff that they still have in... that they still have in their catalog, what little of it is there, you have to buy direct from them or from other anime retailers. It's they're active, yes, but don't make it look like that they're still a major player right now, because they're not a major player right now.
REB. Now here, Ham Salad goes into real asshole mode.
Here we go.
REB says, I'm a fan of Robotech, and also of the three original anime series it was developed from. To which Ham Salad says, sorry, mutually exclusive. You cannot be a fan of a show and the mutilated version thereof. To be one is to insult the other. Really? You are going as far as to say what a person can or cannot be a fan of. You are a douchebag.
I got nothing to say to that. You've rendered me speechless.
Look, you cannot say that he cannot be a fan, because he has just said that he is a fan. What he likes has nothing to do with your opinion.
No. It's laughable that you're trying to put your opinion... you're basically trying to force your opinion upon everyone else, and I think that's where everything falls apart for this guy.
There are no rules to what you can or cannot like. There are no rules.
You lose! Good day, sir!
REB says, in terms of actual editing of film, the Robotech versions of Macross and Mospita are very close to their progenitors. To which Ham Salad says, and no, they are completely different. That's basically been the complaint, along with ham-handed and amateurish work from the beginning. We have just explained how similar Macross is to the Macross saga of Robotech. We have explained the differences.
We've explained how, in the process of doing the master segment with Southern Cross, the master segment also helped out the Southern Cross segment, because the Southern Cross segment was pretty much a failed attempt by the Japanese.
REB says, we have different opinions, to which Ham Salad says, no, I have facts, and you have opinions. The problem with your theories is that they don't connect in any way with what actually happened. You even contradict yourself regularly. There is no such thing as almost the same, unedited dubbing and rewriting, and rewritten uncut film. All of these things are mutually exclusive. Change is changed, cut is cut, dubbed is unoriginal.
Now, where have I heard people use basically that exact frame of reference, that kind of, you know, posing of questions and stuff like that? Gee, I wonder about it for a second. I know the style of counter-argument that really reflects 9/11 truthers. I mean, I'm not kidding. It sounds almost exactly like what one of those folks want to say that want to try to tell us something else was going on that infamous day. Moving on from that quickly before I get even more angry than I already am.
Now,
quickly, I said, quickly!
REB says, if you go to Macross World or any English Macross site, you'll find many fans who are exposed to both Macross and anime in general through Robotech. Please excuse the dog if he's in frame. And I should point out macrossshare.blogspot.com, a very comprehensive blog spot for downloadable media regarding everything of Macross
And
Robotech. Macross Share has it right. You can be fans of both. You can have an appreciation for both. Macross chair. To which Ham Salad says, and no, Robotech is not in fact anime. This sounds awfully familiar. You wonder why I think it's the same person? You cannot change a work and call it the same work. And no, Robotech fans are not Macross fans because Robotech is not Macross. Robotech was made from Macross in the sense that you can make a wrecked car out of a car.
Oh, brother.
Goes on to say, only dub fans enjoy Robotech. You are really cementing yourself in the douchebag pool.
Jeez, I'm ooh! Ah! Please, move on!
REB says, while Macross had some spotty distribution internationally, through Robotech it reached most of the world, including China, where there is a large Macross / Robotech fan base. To which Ham Sal replies, it's a Macross fan base. Robotech is an English product, not a Chinese product. You know something? Macross is a Japanese product, not a Chinese product. F you.
And moreover to that, you're making it believe that maybe they didn't take Robotech and translate it into English in China?
We don't know, really.
We don't know, really, but honestly, that's kind of the implication he's making here.
And here he goes on about how all the Robotech products and spin-offs failed commercially.
Okay, maybe. However, if memory serves, there was one thing that came out not that long ago, a while ago, but not too long ago, that would kind of probably fly in the face of that. Does anyone here remember Robotech the Shadow Chronicles?
Yeah.
Maybe it wasn't the greatest thing in the world, but I have memory of it actually selling quite well.
And upon its release.
I think that the distribution for that series was actually very robust.
And, Harmony Gold and Kickstarter are working on this new RPG miniatures game. That, I've seen on many, many boards saying, oh my god, the new Robotech miniatures game, oh my god, this is going to be so cool. I've seen this many, many places.
I mean, I've been seeing it on Facebook a whole lot because I follow the Robotech fan, the official Robotech page, and I have to give credit where it's due. The official Robotech fan page is probably one of the more robust fan pages when it comes to updating on Facebook, at least for the ones that I follow. So kudos to the people that still that run that Facebook page.
REB says, Masek played a part in furthering the success of Akira. To which Ham Salad says, and no, he caused it to fail in the U.S. Were it not for Masek the Mangler, Akira would now continue to be published, probably with subtitles, and would be shown in art houses.
Wait a second!
Akira Blu-rays and DVDs are readily available.
Bandai.
The manga is readily available.
Bandai re-released that thing on Blu-ray and DVD like 2 years ago. 2 or 3 years ago. Don't give me that crap that it's not, that it's disappeared from the marketplace. I mean, okay, maybe you gotta do a little bit of digging, but it's hardly gone. It's not out of print for all I know.
You can go on Amazon, you will see several different releases of Akira.
That is, of course, unless Bandai Entertainment, because they went under, that it's impossible to get now. I almost forgot about that point.
REB says, the art house engagements it received caused it to come to the attention of a lot of the electronic media in the U.S., including the coup of a great review on the well-regarded Siskel and Ebert at the Movies TV series. No other anime film had received that kind of press and accolades at the time, and it was due to the efforts of Masek and Streamline. To which Ham Salad counters, there was nothing else out at the time.
So what?
Actually, a few years later, you know what else Siskel and Ebert reviewed on their show? Ghost in the Shell. Yeah. That was where I first heard of Ghost in the Shell, on Siskel and Ebert.
And Roger Ebert does have knowledge of reviewing other things.
Rest in peace.
May he rest in peace. I remember hearing, actually on Anime World Order, that he actually reviewed the Katsuhiro Otomo film, or should I say the Hiroyuki Kitakubo film, Raijin Z, which Otomo had a lot of involvement in.
Ham Salad says, as far as I know, the voice actors from Robotech are not currently working in anime.
Freeze!
And bad dubs in general are on the incline, so there's no card yet. Yeah, okay. Freeze.
Freeze for a second. Let's go over some of the people that are still doing some of the voice actors.
First and foremost, Tony Oliver.
Tony Oliver is still getting work.
Yeah.
Maybe not as an anime voice actor, but at the same time, he is hardly...
The most recent anime credits I can think of for Tony Oliver would be the aforementioned Robotech the Shadow Chronicles, the aforementioned Lupin the Third series, and Vandred.
So, yeah, I mean maybe stuff that's a little bit old, but it's hard to think that that he's completely gone from the scene. And for the most part, he still shows up at conventions on a regular basis. So it's hard to think that he's completely gone from the scene. Another person,
Barbara Goodson.
Barbara Goodson. How many things can we say?
Yeah.
About
not
her?
Working in anime anymore.
Maybe not working.
Really?
Maybe not. But at the same time, it's not as though she's not getting work. Cam Clark.
Leonardo from the original Ninja Turtle. Leonardo from the Ninja Turtle series. To say he's not working in anime anymore, he was just recently Professor Xavier in the X-Men anime adaptation.
And maybe the one that comes to mind is Reba West, but even she has a...
Mihoshi from Tenchi Muyo.
And she was also not only... Lelouch's little sister in Code Geass. So it's not as though these people are, I mean, you're making it sound like these people aren't getting work anymore or have been forgotten. They haven't been.
RAB says, ADV was once the shining star of anime distribution in the US, outshining all others. They're gone now. But did they grow the market and expand the reach of anime's influence, to which Ham Salad says, nope. In fact, they followed a failed business model and so failed themselves. Others take heed.
Please continue.
R.E.B. The point is hard to defend when even Bandai is giving up the ghost when it comes to distributing anime, at least in the States. To which A Ham Salad says, could it be because the American director of the Bandai US has followed the MASIC model?
Freeze! What are you talking about?
Really?
Okay, we're gonna go back here to listening to podcasts. Alright, we're gonna put links to two podcast episodes in the description. One of them is gonna be from the aforementioned Anime World Order podcast, where they spent an entire hour plus talking about the end of Bandai and the various factors therein. Another episode that I'm going to put to you as well is a ANN cast, the Anime News Network cast, in which they interviewed Robert Napton, who was the former merchandising director at Bandai Entertainment. Both of those podcasts, when you listen to them, you will have a clear understanding of what happened at the end. What happened at the end for Bandai wasn't the fact that the American people were following a failed business model. It was the fact that the parent company in Japan made it so goddamn difficult for them to operate in this market by A, not allowing their products to be streamed on services such as Netflix, Hulu, and other places, and B, having to pay for shows that Bandai Japan already owns. So if you want to tell me that it's an American fault that Bandai Entertainment is no longer with us, God rest their souls, You come and you try to talk to me, and you listen to those. You take 3 hours out of your life, listen to those two, and you'll have a better understanding of not only what happened to Bandai Entertainment, but you'll have a better understanding of how the anime industry actually works. You.
You okay? Now, REB says many would be hard pressed to say that Bandai was not successful. To which, now this is hilarious.
Oh, no.
To which Ham Salad says, I wouldn't. If you make a product that people want to buy, they buy it. This causes success. Bandai US made bad dubs. People didn't buy them or broadcast them.
What?
End of business.
What? What? They really say that?
Really?
Wait a minute.
No one watched these?
From the Gundam universe, a new chapter in one of the greatest anime sagas of all time. Gundam Wing. Weekdays at 5:30. Suit up. Big O, starting Monday, April 2nd at 5:30. Good guys still wear black.
Tsunami is proud to present the most groundbreaking anime saga of all time. Fully restored, Mobile Suit Gundam. Premieres Monday, July 23rd at 5. Suit up for the first time.
Take this, my love, my anger, and all of my sorrow!
You intend to shoot your own brother?
You will never be forgiven!
G Gundam, premiering next Monday at 5, only Toonami.
Bounty to bounty and outlaw to outlaw. One ship, one crew, one destiny. Cowboy Bebop.
Legendary cyberpunk classic finally comes to television in an all-new original series, Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex. Premiering Saturday, November 6th at 12:30. The future is now.
Outlaw Star. Premiering Monday, January 15th at 6:30. Time to roll the dice.
Supposedly. He can't even realize that it's 47 people that disagreed with him at the time of that writing, and then 4 people that actually did agree with him. He can't even do basic mathematics! What the heck?
He goes on. Tatsunoko Productions had nothing to do with the dubbing of Robocrud. That is a blatant lie, and I have personally discussed this with Tatsunoko and their offices in Japan. They had no idea what was being done to the show in the U.S. until it was too late, and regretted the ignorance of foreign laws that made Bozotech possible at all.
We already addressed that before.
Where is your proof?
Yeah,
your word.
I mean, it's your word, and of course, you know, we've gone over about how Ishiguro and Kawamori both were surprised at the treatment that Macross got in America, but at the same time, I do think that if they would have been furious about the treatment that it got in Japan, you probably would have heard something.
You would hear a lot more about it. You would see them openly speaking about it.
They probably would have made sure that they probably would have made sure that Carl Masek never got any of their products again.
And going back to the 51 people, 4 people thing, he says, the fact that 4 agree with me proves that the other 51 are merely Robo fans spamming the reviews, since Robo Blank is roundly hated by the anime fans in general, as I've already proved.
How?
It's pretty much unwatchable.
Why?
You're a moron.
I mean, seriously. As I've said, basic mathematics all aside, what have you proved in this whole thing other than you're an asshole?
yes. He says, I don't claim anything. The fact that I have done work in the anime industry was mentioned because someone else brought it up. What have you worked on? What have you worked on?
Again, an IMDb, a LinkedIn, an anime news network page, anything. I will take that as long as it gives me proof.
He goes on, in point of fact, ADVision made what is said to be a better, more accurate bad dub than RoboBelch. If your issue was actually that you just don't like subtitles, you'd want that. So the idea that you're pretending not to be a RoboFart fan is pretty transparent.
I mean, where do you go from this? I mean, there's no reasoning with this guy. There's absolutely zero reasoning with this guy.
In regards to what a commenter said about his life, he says, finally, yes, I do have a good life. For example, I did work in the anime business for a few years.
With who?
And that's something no RoboButt fan has ever managed.
Tommy Yoon is now basically the holder to the keys of the Robotech franchise now, thank you very much.
And he was a fan. Besides being a success in my careers, I'm also quite well off financially and married for decades to a now ex-model who has a career of her own.
Seriously, again, burden
right.
of proof. You stupid, stupid
yeah,
son of a
bitch. Isn't that
bitch.
What they all say?
Yeah, really. And I think we're getting closer to the end.
Yeah, we're pretty much at the end of this.
I mean, where else can you go? You can't really go anywhere else from here. It's frustrating. It's head-scratching. It makes you want to hit your head across the door several times.
It makes us ashamed to be fans of anime.
It really does. And, I mean, I'm gonna go ahead and go off on a tangent here and talk about it. Because I've been building up talking about the attitude of this guy.
This guy's attitude.
It's so self-absorbed. It is so self-aggrandizing. It is so focused on himself and what he wants, with very little common decency for the other people that are in this thread. The bottom line, and again, I put this out at the outset when we addressed this originally. If I'm not a fan of something, I'm not going to spend my time over the course of weeks and really rip something to shreds just because I don't like it. My philosophy is that if you like it, if you get entertainment out of it, by all means, embrace it. Go with it. There's nothing that you should be worried about. But at the same time, you shouldn't have to be forced to defend yourself against this type of person. This type of person who obviously has something loose in his head where he can't see that he's being the dick and everyone else is just being the reasonable human beings.
Yeah. I mean,
again, like 9/11 and 9/11 truthers and other conspiracy theory nonsense folks who think that their truth is the only thing that works, regardless of what facts come out.
I mean, the guy is constantly throwing insults at people, and if someone tries to insult him back, even in a mild way, he makes himself the victim.
Which is bullshit.
And saying that the fact that he says that they're making it about themselves.
Oh.
And to,
what a laugh. Him accusing everyone else about making it of themselves when he's the one who keeps on posting and 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 posting. Thank you.
we appreciate if you've held on as long with this as we've done this. I mean, this was a real chore for us, and it was probably a real chore for you to stick around, but this is stuff that really needed to be said, and this needs to get out.
We
you
need
know,
to defend our places.
Subscribe, share, whatever can be done. This needs to be heard.
We need to really say that that anything is safe for people, for moderates. I mean, that's the biggest problem, I think, in this country, and it's just in general, is that there's no room for being a moderate anymore. You have to be an extreme, or you have to be an extreme one way or the other, and there's no going back. And I don't subscribe to that, but it really just feels like that when it comes to geek fandoms, it almost feels like that's a requirement these days, and it's terrible. I mean, let's look at the most recent Star Trek film. We just saw that yesterday. The fact is that I went in there seeing it, and I feel as though, even though a lot of people say that this didn't hold up very well to the first one, I honestly think it holds up very well to the first one, and I think that both movies can honestly be considered even in quality. I really believe that. I felt as though but no, so many of the purists out there for Star Trek always want to say, oh, you know what, this isn't about this isn't Roddenberry's vision. This isn't what I always expected Star Trek to be.
This is Jar Jar Abrams.
I mean, whatever. You know what? Star Trek is now in the 21st century. It's not a problem if Mr. Abrams or whoever is going to be at the helms after Into Darkness decides to take things in a different direction.
Things must be allowed to evolve.
Yes. Fandoms should be allowed to evolve. The products that we watch should be allowed to evolve.
I don't want change! I don't want change! Everything has to stay the same!
And if the artist wants to go back and make a change to something that he created, which we're getting back into something that we've talked about from the very beginning on this channel, the people who want to complain about someone else taking their product and altering it should shut up and let us enjoy it, because you know something? It's not your product. It is his. He controls it.
Bottom line, if you're a fan of something, especially with anime, if you're a fan of anime, watch it however you like to watch it.
Absolutely.
Don't let someone else tell you how it must be seen. Don't let them tell you what is or what isn't when it comes to what you like.
Now, don't take this advice meaning that you shouldn't ask for advice when it comes to finding out what you want to watch and what you want to get interested in. What we're saying here is make sure that if you got someone who is being extremely, and I do stress that term, extremely pushy about a particular subject, it might be a good time to maybe step aside and maybe look for someone else for guidance. I don't think that's an unreasonable expectation, because that is how I got into anime. I talked to someone that I knew in school about it, and he directed me as a fan towards other things, and then after I discovered those things, I went out on my own and I discovered so many other things that I enjoy, and I still love it to this day. I'm gonna love it until I go in the to quote Vince Russo, I'll love it until the day I go in the goddamn grave, which hopefully isn't anytime soon. But goddamn it, I'm not about ready to let some punk elitist come in here and try to tell me how I should enjoy my shows, what shows I should or shouldn't enjoy. I'm going to say this right now. Macross is one of those shows. If I had probably grown up with it, I probably would have been an anime fan a lot sooner in my youth. But seeing it now and watching it now, I have so much more respect for the people that made it, for a person like Carl Masek. Yes, stuff that he has done has not worked out completely over the years. There's no denying that. However, Carl Masek's legacy should not be one of someone who just tarnished anime. Yes, he has the Masaker label on the TV Tropes fan page, but that is a misnomer. That is a misnomer because what he did in creating the Robotech universe is something that I doubt will ever be accomplished again. Being able to take something
and streamline
from three separate stories, and even though it may not have been perfect, even though there might have been plot holes, even though there may have been things that did not make a lick of sense, the fact of the matter is, Masek and Streamline were able to take three separate shows and make an entire universe out of it. That, if nothing else, should be applauded and should be recognized as a true artistic achievement in the history of anime in the U.S. Yes, don't like Masek for what he had to say about subtitles. Don't like Masek for maybe some of the precedents that he set when it came to other companies who've tried to do what he did. However, the man himself gave us something I think that is so vastly underrated and so vast and just needs to be appreciated. I honestly believe that Carl Masek would want us to just sit down. And honestly, I honestly think that if Carl Masek were still around today, if he could listen to some people say, oh, you know, I want to watch Macross, I don't think he would have a problem. I don't think that he would shake his head the other way and just force anyone to watch Robotech. I think that he would let it go as it is. He would probably just be grateful for anyone to watch Robotech, and he would probably just love it if enough people actually went out and watched Macross as well. I think that's what Masek's legacy really is, the fact that he gave us this. Yes, it was Super Dimensional Fortress Macross in Japan. In here, it's Robotech, and it was edited. It was altered slightly, but at the same time, it's still our show here in the United States. He created something, I think, that deserves recognition and deserves, if at the very least, at least a nod for achievement, because there's no way you can get away with what Masek did in the 80s today. There's no way that you could do that. I mean, because it's too easy for anyone to go on a simple Google search and to look up information about shows that are releasing in Japan. It's just way too easy. There's no way you could make another Robotech today unless you did something completely original. And even then, that's a tough deal to go through.
So, anything else to say to wrap this up?
All I can say is, you know what? Just enjoy what you enjoy. I mean, whatever it is, be it anime, video games, pro wrestling, sports, whatever. Go out and enjoy what you love. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. You know, if you have thin enough skin where it's really going to be something that maybe you would think twice as to why you would watch it, I don't know. Maybe you shouldn't, but at the same time, I like to think that enough people have thick enough skin where even if you're watching something that's a little bit embarrassing, that you can take it. I certainly think that there's no shame in liking certain things. I certainly believe that that's what we've gone over ad nauseum today. I do believe that we can really come together as a fandom, even though that this is really, that fandoms can really splinter and break apart at times. I do believe that anime fans at their hearts love the product. Anime fans at their heart love the freedom that this medium offers. And I think that as long as we're going to be as long as we're around here, there's no reason for us not to be fans. I don't know any other way to put it than that. I'm gonna be an anime fan for as long as I can, and I don't think that anyone's ever gonna be able to stop me.
That's the same for me.
I mean, what else can I say? What else can I say other than, you know what? If you're an elitist, if you're one of these purists, whatever. Say what you want.
No.
You're just gonna be a whisper in the background to us. Because you know what? We're just gonna blow right past every single one of you, and we're just gonna watch things the way that we wanna watch it.
With me to the elitist, you know, if you're gonna be an elitist, all I have to say is go fuck yourself. This is MC Square.
And the Otaku Jock.
Domo arigato.